Imagine looking up at the night sky centuries ago and attempting to map the thousands of bright stars that you could see with the naked eye. Or consider the mystery of the rainbow as it suddenly materializes out of sunlight and mist.
In our busy society, it's not every day we get to experience a sense of wonder at the world and our place in it. But for thousands of years, scientists, artists, and philosophers have sought to understand our place in the universe, all because of the wonder of the world around us.
Oh, hey there. Welcome to a new season of Becoming Artsy. You're putting away my new office with me. You know, I'm really excited for this new season because filming it has not only coincided with a few changes happening in my life, but also this groundbreaking cultural initiative that's happening all across Southern California. It's called PST Art, and this year's theme is Art and Science Collide. What it means for the season is that I get to explore stories behind exhibitions that are at the intersection of art and science, which I love, because one of those topics I'd like to think that I know a little bit about. And one of those topics, I feel like I'm still learning about. Oh, that's interesting. So let's go learn some more things. That's, I'm supposed to walk off camera, it's tracking me. Oy, yoy, yoy.
Since antiquity, humans have been trying to understand the science of light as it relates to the cosmos and the natural world. But what many people don't realize is that the Middle Ages was actually an incredible time for scientific inquiry.
I do wonder sometimes why the Middle Ages don't get as much credit for their scientific inquiry as the Enlightenment. And I think part of it is that science and the divine were really intertwined back then. And the study of light is such a great example of this because you can see in the art from that time, light rays coming down from the heavens, or my personal favorite, Jesus on a rainbow.
From antiquity, the rainbow has been associated with divinity. God sent out the rainbow as a sign to Noah that the flood was over. In medieval Christian art, we often have Christ seated on a rainbow as the divine judge who will come at the end of time.
The rainbow is just one example of the connection to light in the Middle Ages. And it's also a connection to this contemporary exhibition currently in Getty's entrance hall.
This piece, Spectrum 14 by Charles Ross, he wants to connect you to the movement of the Earth, both rotating on its axis, but also moving around the sun. And it's a way to ground people in thinking about the sort of celestial motion that a medieval person would have to be able to do in order to know the seasons, in order to navigate, and do many other rituals. You start to realize that it's really over generation after generation that the entire world accumulated these maps of the sky. That feels like something maybe very medieval, that we're trying to map the stars, but I suddenly realized, wait, we're still doing this now.
We're still trying to figure it out, and we're still so far from really knowing.
We might not know the answers, but there's a comfort in knowing that we're all still looking, and not even in that different of a way.
Sitting in this space and bathing in the rainbows, you can really feel a connection to the light and the movement of the cosmos, our place on Earth in relation to the sun, and of course, the beauty of the colors. And there's one other connection to the Middle Ages here, and that's the optical science behind how these rainbows are formed. The prisms in the ceiling are a direct result of the scientific study of light in the Middle Ages.
So how did they figure out that prisms cast rainbows?
If you've seen the Pink Floyd Dark Side of the Moon album cover, you know that light enters a prism and then goes out into a rainbow.
If you see the rainbow in the sky, right, mm-hmm. You can see light in many different colors. People, of course, have theorized about the rainbow for thousands of years as well. So Aristotle is best known for being one of the first to theorize that when sun hits water droplets and is then deflected at a fixed angle into our eyes. That's how we see a rainbow.
I met with historian Margaret Gaeta in Santa Monica to talk about the study of light and optics, and in particular, to learn about the camera obscura.
People have been wondering for thousands of years how things work. Yeah. It's that sense of wonder that's inspired by things like the rainbow and the function of the human eye.
So Aristotle was studying the rainbow and light in ancient Greece, and unlike his mentor Plato, who thought that our ability to see came from this fire or light inside of our eyes directed outwards, Aristotle believed that it was actually light from the outside coming into our eyes that allowed us to see. And spoilers, Aristotle was right.
Ibn al-Haytham in the 11th century in his book on optics postulated that light rays entering from outside of the eye allows us to see. Ibn al-Haytham was also one of the first to describe a camera obscura. One of the most important things to really appreciate when we think about something like the camera obscura is just that science does have a story, and it has a long story, it has a long history. And so our ideas in the past really informed the development of science over time.
Now, the camera obscura that al-Haytham described would eventually be improved upon with lenses and given its fancy name, camera obscura, but the mechanics are the same. Light coming in through a small hole into an enclosed space will cast an inverted image of what is outside onto the surface inside.
We're so used to seeing images on a screen, on a phone screen, but this image is produced just from a hole in the ceiling of this building. That's it. And if we had special chemicals, right, we would be able to take an actual picture.
Lighting isn't just about what we see, it can also influence the way that we feel. Lighting can set the mood for a romantic dinner or a dance party. And back in medieval times, lighting was beginning to be used in places of worship to make people feel a sense of wonder and closer to God. They did this using stained glass windows, the play of light and shadows on carved stone, luminous hanging glass mosque lamps, and lots of candles. I can just imagine how it would feel to walk into a place and see this completely lit up. To me, one of the coolest things is that medieval scientists weren't just figuring out the optics of light. They were trying to figure out why and how it affects the way that we feel.
Our story of light and vision is part of a larger story about the five senses and the connection between the senses and the brain. How does wonder occur? They believed that the brain was divided into three chambers called ventricles, and the information was processed from one ventricle to the next, the kind of biological distillery, as it were. Here, there's the wonderful brain man that shows all of the little chambers that information coming in through the eyes then is processed through each ventricle, and it finally results in cognition or knowledge.
Oh, so that's why you see the rays of light coming into the people's heads.
Exactly.
Because the light is knowledge.
Yes, and knowledge is divine.
If you think about it, things like Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, this video, none of these things would exist if it hadn't have been for people figuring out light throughout history, from mapping the sun and the stars in order to tell time, to the discovery of the refraction of light, which explained rainbows and how we see, and the fact that our eyes are lenses, and then we have lenses in the camera. And even before that, the principles of the camera obscura led us to the photographic camera, which led us to the digital camera. And now the digital camera is in all of our cell phones. And yeah, sometimes we're using all of that technology, all of that knowledge to scroll on our phones. I particularly really like the chicken videos.
Feeding spaghetti to my chickens.
And other times we use all of that knowledge to create our own cozy little spaces and experience our own sense of wonder. Thank you so much for watching. I know there's so much content out there. I would genuinely love to hear what your favorite thing about light is. Cozy spaces you've created for yourself. You wanna go down the rabbit hole of wave or particle? Let's do it. I'll see you next time.